start this party. Are y'all ready?
We're ready. We're ready.
I was going to dress up, but I didn't get dressed up. Y'all don't mind, do you? I don't dress up unless I'm on television. All right, am I supposed to stand up here behind this thing?
I guess so.
Okay, I'm sorry.
I'm supposed to stand behind this thing so you can hear me. All right, I've always got a lot of things to say, and I never do a prepared talk. For those that don't know me, I have been doing the weather on television here since the Civil War. The only guy that's been on television longer than me in Birmingham is a guy named Country Boy Eddie. And most of you don't know who that is. And if you do, you've been here a long time. Eddie was on television 37 years. I've been on television 34. Three more and I'll be at the record. I started doing this back in, on my first television weather job was in 1978 in Tuscaloosa. Went to Montgomery to Channel 12 and then to Birmingham to Channel 13. I replaced a lady named Rosemary at 13. When I was a little boy, you watched either Pat Gray or Rosemary Lucas on television. If you watched the weather a long time ago, I replaced Rosemary on Channel 13. And it's been quite a ride. I guess a lot of what's still on my mind today is what happened last year. We had a bad day last year. April 27th was what I call a generational tornado outbreak. It really and truly, I don't think it's generational in the classic sense, in that we typically have one of those every 40 years. Now, the next time we have one, I will be at Elmwood Cemetery, all right? I'm out. But the one before that got me into this. The event similar to that that happened 40 years ago was April 3rd, 1974. In that night, Alabama had 80 people that were killed. A town called Ewan was blown away. And I was a senior in high school in 1974. My hobby was ham radio. And let me say this, the year prior to that, the first time I ever saw tornado damage in my life was right down the street. I was a junior in high school in May of 1973. And my hobby then, my hobby is still today, ham radio. There were no cell phones back in the 70s. And there was an urgent need down here, and they called us down here. We were probably some of the first people from Tuscaloosa to get here in 1973. And that night was life-changing because I'd never seen anything like that. I saw my friend Jerry Powell out here. I first met Jerry after that. He was at the Brent Baptist Church. You know, a man died in the church. His name was Andrew Mitchell. I remember this stuff like it was yesterday, and this was in 1973. But the next year, what they did, they allowed me off from school for 3 days to go volunteer. And my first stop that night, they put me in the hospital in Jasper, Alabama. The hospital at the time was the People's Hospital, and for whatever reason, they put me in the emergency department. And I don't know why they did that. We were relaying information from the hospital back to Birmingham. But let me tell y'all something, I lost my innocence that night. I saw things an 18-year-old child should never see. Things I've never talked about. I've never talked about them in public. I've never talked about them in private. The grotesque nature of the wounds I saw that night, I guess, were in some way, shape, or form, might be similar to what an American would see in combat fighting in Vietnam. I had night terrors for years about what I saw that night. I guess it was meant to be. I don't know. But I was a child of the 70s, a child of those outbreaks, of this outbreak in 73 and the super outbreak in 74. So all of a sudden it happens again. And by the way, prior to 1974, the last time we had a big outbreak that was on March 21st, 1932. And no, I wasn't doing the weather on television back then. I have no idea how many people died that day. We don't know. We try and piece it together, we just don't know. I think the death toll statewide was over 700. And understand, there were no tornado warnings in 1932, but let me tell you something. You go down the road places like Plantersville, it was eaten alive by huge, violent tornadoes in that outbreak. But last year, let me tell you something. I didn't talk about it for 6 months. I was invited to speak on that outbreak all over the country, and I opted not to because, I'll be honest with you, I didn't know what to say. I still to this day struggle with what happened that day. Does anybody know how many people died in our state that day? 252 died in one day from weather. And if you were to ever tell me that's going to happen one day on my watch, I'd say you're crazy. Something went wrong. I thought the death toll should have been about 30, and 30 is horrible. That is a horrible, horrible tragedy. But 252, that's unspeakable. These were precious people that died. And you know what had happened on my watch? And I'm really tired of funerals. I don't want this to happen. But the one thing I think I learned that day, I'm not as good as I think I am. I think for a lot of us, when you've been doing a job for a long, long time, you think you're kind of good at it, you're cruising along, and all of a sudden something happens and you realize you're not as good as you think you are. That's what happened to me last year. Something went wrong that day. The average lead time for every single tornado, and yes, I know we had a huge number of tornadoes. In one day, we had 62 tornadoes in one day. The average lead time was over 30 minutes. 30 minutes to go to a safe place. 30 minutes. And most of the bodies were found in places adjacent to a safe room. So either they didn't hear the warning, or they heard the warning and they chose not to do anything, or maybe they didn't know what to do. I don't know. It was hard. It started off, remember, we had a morning event. At about 5, 6 o'clock in the morning. Had a lull, then we had the afternoon event. I guess the hardest one for me was the Tuscaloosa tornado. And some of you know my story. I mean, most of you have heard me speak somewhere. You've heard enough of me. I'm surprised anybody showed up here meeting for me. Everybody's heard James Spann. But for those that don't know, when I was a little boy, I lived in a small town in South Alabama called Greenville. I bet you never heard of it, have you? You have not? Really? You can't get to Greenville from here. I don't think there's any roads that go down there from here. Greenville's a small town between Montgomery and Mobile. I'm from deep South Alabama. My accent is Butler County. I can't help it. I am who I am. I tell people all the time, if you don't like me, take it up with God because he made me this way, you know? Some lady the other day, she was so mad at me, the veins were bulging out on her neck. You ever had somebody so mad at you, their face is red, and the veins are starting to just pop out? And you know what she was mad about? This little patch of hair right here. Now, you can barely even see anymore. I said, ma'am, why are you so mad? She said, you ought to cut that thing off. I'm proud of that. That's all I can grow. I mean, and I wanted to say, if you're mad, take it up with God, because, you know, this is I am who I am. But I love Greenville. Let me tell you something. I loved it. But something happened to me when I was in second grade. That's a tender age, by the way, 7 years old. It would change my life. One night, my father abandoned me and my mom in the middle of the night like a jackrabbit. I'm a fatherless child. My mama to this day calls me a half orphan. I guess I am. She said, that half orphan up there in Wisconsin getting that award last week. It hurt, y'all. Let me tell you something. Little boys love their daddies. Now, they love their mamas. They love their daddies. And my father never said goodbye, have a nice life, or see you later. My father left us in the middle of the night. He never paid 1 cent of child support. I know what it's like to hurt. I know what it's like to be broke. I know a lot of things that a lot of people maybe don't know. But we had to move away from Greenville. My mama was the secretary at Greenville High School. She's probably making about $500 a year. You try and raise a child on that in 1966. It doesn't work. We moved to this horrible, horrible place called Tuscaloosa. I didn't want to move there. We got there. That's the biggest place I've ever seen, next to Montgomery. I've never seen a place that big. It looked like New York City to me. I remember before we moved to Greenville, one little boy in school, he got up in my face and he said, "Hey, Tuscaloosa stinks." We moved there and guess what? It did. I walked out the door the first morning, it smelled bad. How did that kid know that it smells bad here? Later in the day, I would find out it was an operation by Gulf States Paper Corporation on the Black Warrior River. Y'all ever smelled a paper mill before? Sometimes if the wind was blowing right, it'd drip down here, wouldn't it? But I learned to love Tuscaloosa. And let me just say this. There were some people that encouraged us, loved us, and provided for us. Everybody in this room is going to have some bad times in your life. I don't care who you are. You will have some bad times. And God will put people in your path to help you. The greatest work God does today is through people. And that's a very special place. You won't understand. You will not understand it. You don't know the pain I went through. I'm sorry. You can't. But it's a special place. And having to watch that thing live on television that day last year, live on TV, was horrible. We knew that if people didn't do the right thing, they had no hope. We knew that if they didn't hear the warning, they had no hope. The death toll in Tuscaloosa alone was 53. Those were incredibly special people. One of those that died was a man named Calvin Hanna. He did a newspaper article on me when I was 14 years old in the Tuscaloosa News because I had a ham radio license. To this day, I don't know why he did that story, but he gave a hurting child some self-esteem that really needed it. He was killed last year. He's an older senior adult. All the other names, it's bad. So what I want to do today is just share some things we have learned. After we kind of caught our breath, and I've been through every emotion with this thing. I've been through anger, and I've been through depression. I've been through it all. It's like having 252 people in your family lose their life just like that. And it happened under your watch. But we're rolling up our sleeves. We're getting busy. We're getting serious. We're getting to work. We've learned through social scientists. These are people that understand human behavior. We don't. We're all trained in weather. My first major in college up here at the university was electrical engineering, and I finished in meteorology at Mississippi State. They don't teach you anything about human behavior. The only thing I know about human behavior is watching people at the Walmart. Which actually, you can learn a lot by watching people in the Walmart. I'm just saying. We've learned some things about what went wrong that day. And I want to share some of the things we've learned. Hopefully it will help you because it will happen again. I don't know when. Again, I think the next time we have a day like that will be after most of us are somewhere else. But let me say this. You know, every time we have bad weather, what's the first question people ask now? Is this going to be as bad as April 27th? And of course the answer is no. But you know what? I quit answering that because let me tell you something. You get one EF2 tornado coming down your street, guess what? That's your April 27th. It doesn't matter if that's the only tornado in the whole country. That's your big day. So it doesn't matter. We've got to be ready no matter what. But we have learned one of the greatest reasons for this loss of life last year is what we call the siren mentality, and that has to stop. We had a tornado outbreak January 23rd of this year, right after Christmas, about a month after Christmas. Tornadoes came through the Birmingham metropolitan area in the middle of the night, in the pre-dawn hours. Two people were killed, and that's too many, but the death toll could have been a lot higher. The system worked very well that night, but what broke my heart was one of those two deaths. Now, one was an older gentleman. He lived a wonderful life. I believe he was pushing 90. It was just his time. But the other one that died, she was 16 years old, Christina Heichelbeck. She was brilliant. Student at Shades Valley High School, honors student, incredibly gifted. She was killed by the tornado. The parents survived in the house. The grieving parents said later that day the words we never want to hear again. You know what they said? We never heard the siren. They thought they were going to hear a siren at 4 o'clock in the morning in their house, which is absolute insanity. Now, I'll warn you, I'm going to sound like an old Southern Baptist preacher here for a couple of minutes. And I'm a Southern Baptist, so I can sound like one. By the way, I'm a children's minister. For those that know me, my congregation on Sunday mornings, they just happen to be between the ages of 5 and 12 years old. and typically, my sermons are really short. I can close my eyes and I can see Christina's face. Let me tell you, I've always been nice about this issue, but I'm not, I'm being very bold about it now. The head of the National Weather Service is being very bold. He has a 16-year-old daughter. Now, we have boys. He has a 16-year-old daughter, and that really touched him. For whatever reason, people in this state are born with the notion that you should hear some air raid siren before a tornado. You know what, when air raid siren technology started? World War I. Here we are today in 2012 thinking that's gonna save people from tornadoes. It's ridiculous. There are days I am so frustrated and so angry. You know what I wanna do? Take them down and burn them. Guess what? If they don't exist, then you know you won't hear one. You know you won't hear one. But yet to this day, after even this morning, I got a note from somebody that said, I need to talk to somebody about getting me a siren close to my house because I can't hear the one. Well, you could have one in your backyard and you won't hear it when you're sound asleep in the middle of a storm. It has killed countless Alabamians over the years. And let me say this, Christina's parents are very big advocates now. I wish I could take them everywhere. You've heard enough of James Spann. I am a bag of hot air, you know. You bring in those two parents that lost their 16-year-old daughter because they thought they were going to hear a siren. They will look you in the eyes with tears streaming down their face, begging you to stop relying on a siren. They'll beg you. And if you don't care about you, do it for somebody that you love. So the biggest issue we had that night were people relying on sirens. Yeah, I know they serve a purpose. They reach a limited number of people where? Outdoors. That's it. They've never been designed to reach you in a house. I remember when I was a little boy in Greenville, we were within range of the Cuban missiles. I would imagine I'm the only guy in this room old enough to recall the Cuban missile crisis of the early 60s. But they had missiles and they could aim up the United States. Greenville was within range. And they taught us, when you hear the sirens, you need to do this at school. We had to get under our desks. And at the house, you had to do this. And even then, in 1962, I remembered, there's something wrong with this because I can't hear that siren at home or at school. And here we are in 2012 still using them. I'm begging you to please stop. The baseline, every home should have, it's a weather radio, okay? Now, they cost about $29. I know some people can't afford a $29 weather radio. But if you can afford a $29 weather radio, I beg you to go buy one. I'm not really supposed to tell you where to buy them. I don't like having conflicts with any of this stuff, but you can buy them in a lot of places, and a lot of people around here know where to buy them. You program them by counties. That's the baseline. If you don't have one, this is your homework. I give out homework. Go buy one today. I believe in the state, and we're getting our research back in to back this up, less than 5% of our people have weather radios in their home. And that's going to kill more and more and more and more people every time we have bad weather. People relying on these stinking sirens. Can you tell I don't like sirens? Goodness gracious. You mentioned the word siren. If I had any hair, you know what I'd do? I'd pull it out. By the way, when you forecast the weather in Alabama, this is what you look like. This is after years of pulling it out. I ain't got nothing left to pull. Some of you might have a fancy phone. I wish everybody had a device like this because the beautiful thing about these, there's a little chip in there that knows where you are. And warnings are not based on entire counties. They are based on very small parts of counties, polygons. And the way these work, if you're in the polygon, you get the warning. And if you're not, you don't. If there's a tornado down here on the Chilton County line, you don't need to do anything up here. But yet, with the old county-based system, everybody in the whole county, they were doing things. You don't need to do that anymore. But a weather radio at the minimum, these phones, they're applications that work beautifully. If you have one, talk to me later. I'll tell you how to get one. But everybody in here needs a weather radio. Another thing we've learned that was a problem, guess what? By the way, if you don't have a weather radio, that's your problem. The next issue, guess whose problem it is? It's mine. It's ours. It's a weather enterprise. We issue too many warnings that are false. How many warnings, tornado warnings, do you think are false in Alabama? 80%. Boy, if I was that bad and forecasted the weather every day, they would have fired me 30 years ago. I don't issue the warnings. It's issued by the National Weather Service, and they're very good friends, but they're doing something that we just can't do. The greatest thing missing in my science is humility. Let me tell y'all something. There's a lot of things we don't know, and there's a lot of things we can't do. And we cannot warn for every little spin-up tornado that lasts for 30 seconds. And by trying to catch those things and issue warning after warning after warning after warning that are false, it forces us on television, makes everybody mad. We cover up Dancing with the Stars and football and NASCAR. Everybody gets mad. We've got to stop that as a weather community. And I will assure you, we are working on it. I don't issue the warnings. I've made a commitment. If there's a warning for Bibb County, Alabama, I'm going to go on TV no matter what's on. And goodness gracious, if I ever think I'm something special, I have a folder called hate mail. We had a tornado in 1998 that killed 34 people in Birmingham. 34 people died. It's horrible. And when it was over, we'd been on television about 10 hours. They wanted me to fly in the helicopter the next morning to fly over the damage path because I was familiar with the territory and I was glad to do that. I knew I needed to get a little bit of sleep, so when I got off the air, I thought I'd do something normal to kind of settle down. And boy, I made a big mistake. Guess what I did? I checked my answering machine. Oh, first lady on that thing chewed me out. She said, "You cut off my story." Now, a lot of you don't know what that means. I do. If an older lady says you cut off her story, you cut off her soap opera. There's a program on my channel at 2 o'clock in the afternoon called General Hospital. All right? I've never seen it. I've never watched that in all these years. But this woman was mad because we cut that thing off and she started talking ugly on that message. She was cussing. She talked ugly about my mama. Now, let me tell you something. You don't do that. You talk ugly about me all day, and I'll just love on you. You talk ugly about my mama, you got to deal with me. And then she hung up on me. Was anybody here that made that call? I'm going to find that lady one day. And by the way, it is a very bizarre world we live in. You wouldn't believe. If you could walk a mile in my shoes, it'd be kind of scary. But I choose to be optimistic. I choose to believe that most people are good. There's some folks in the world that you just wouldn't believe. But having said all that, we have way too many false alarms. And I want to assure you, as a weather community, we are working to reduce the number of false alarms. That's a problem. It was a problem that resulted in loss of life. Because what happens when tornado warnings are issued and nothing happens? You don't do anything. You hear warning after warning after warning and nothing happens, and what do? Well, that stuff goes off all the time. I'm not going to do anything. We think that killed people April 27th. The lack of action because of false warnings, and that's on our back. Hey, you don't have a weather radio. That's your problem you got to fix. This is one we've got to fix. That was a big problem. Another problem we have in our state, many of our folks live in mobile homes. Wonderful, affordable housing. I've done a lot of ministry work around this state in a lot of different places. Let me tell you what, it's a godsend. I'm a big fan of mobile homes. People think that doesn't make sense, but I am. Having said that, during a tornado warning for people to live in a mobile home, you have one rule. What rule do you think that is? Get out. I heard a man representing the mobile home lobby in front of Congress saying that mobile homes are perfectly safe during a tornado. Anybody that says that's crazy is a lunatic. Most people that die in Alabama, they die in cars or mobile homes during tornado outbreaks. Now, April 27th, we had them dying in all kind of situations. But most of the outbreaks is mobile homes. And the problem we've got is that for many people, you know what? They don't have a place to go. So thank goodness for this place. You're lucky. Let me take that back. You're blessed. I don't believe in such thing as luck. A lot of our state, they don't have a place like this. And let me say, we can't promise we're going to give you a 30-minute lead time every time. We can a lot of the time, but the average lead time is about 15 minutes for tornadoes. 15 minutes. So for people that live in a mobile home that's isolated, there's no, you know, shelter in the park, they got to drive somewhere. And it's got to be within 15 minutes. And even then, I can't guarantee 15 minutes. And you don't want to be in a car either. That's another death trap. So we've got to come up with a better solution for those that live in mobile homes and shelters. Here's another problem we've learned that resulted in loss of life April 27th. A lot of kids were home alone, and they lost their life. they, number one, didn't know the thing was happening. And I'm not faulting kids. Most children, they're just not going to keep up with the weather. But here's the problem. Some did hear the warnings, and you know what? They didn't know what to do. I speak in schools every day. Normally, when I'm speaking, I have 300 third graders in a gymnasium. Okay, this is a different audience for me. It's awfully quiet in here. I'm used to loud gymnasiums and all these kids because I teach science. But I will ask those kids, and I've been to. I know what you're thinking. That boy don't know Bibb County from the back. He don't know anything about Bibb County. I might surprise you. I might know this county better than you do. You get me on some of these back roads down here. We chased tornadoes back here when I was a kid on some of the roads that you don't even know exist. There's some precious places in this county. There's some pig trails down that Cahaba River this time of the year where the colors are absolutely stunning. And I bet you 80% of the population of this county has never been down those pig trails. I wish I could take you on a tour sometime. The James Spann Bibb County Pig Trail Tour. It's a good time to go to, man. About Halloween is when you need to go down those pig trails. I'm telling you, everybody, look, we have gorgeous mountains. Lookout Mountain, Mentone, DeSoto State Park, Mount Cheehaw. You've seen these on television. They're gorgeous. But the colors that you will see on the pig trails down that riverbank are just stunning. And I'm not talking where folks know about. But anyway, I've been every school in this county, and I asked the kids, how many of your parents have told you what to do in case there's a tornado coming? It's about 50-50, and that's good, because in some places, it might be 1 in, 10%. About half the kids here know what to do. The other half don't know what to do. Many of our tornadoes happen at 3, 4, and 5 o'clock in the afternoon. For many of the older kids, they come home alone. Both parents are working. I'm not faulting the parents for working. Praise the Lord, they are. But in some cases, the older kids come home alone, and they've got to know what they're doing. If they live in a mobile home, they've got to know who's going to pick them up. Where are they going? Last year, we had a big tornado outbreak April 15th, right before April 27th. I call that the forgotten outbreak. We had a situation where three people died in a mobile home down here on the Chilton-Otauga County line. It was horrible. But kids have to know where to go. So you have to have a plan. We've also learned one thing, and I'll stop. I've talked way too long, but I will tell you, there's so much we've learned, and there's so much we've yet to learn. We don't have all the research in, but we've learned this. Many people died April 27th because of the failure in their tornado preparedness of one thing. In many cases, they did the right thing, but they missed one thing. And let me try and share this without being too graphic. In a large, violent tornado, like the type that hit Brent, May 27, 1973, like the one that hit Tuscaloosa, April 27th of last year, like the one that hit Hackleburg, April 27th of last year, in a large, violent tornado, many of those that are exposed are carried aloft. A tornado is a rotating updraft. By the way, many papers in Tuscaloosa were found in North Carolina. That's how long the documents stayed aloft. But the updraft is so intense that humans are carried aloft. And most people that are carried aloft, they lose their life while they are in the air due to shrapnel. And most of the wounds resulting in the loss of life involve the facial and the skull region. We've always thought this to be true, and now we know it is based on solid research, peer-reviewed research from the University of Alabama at Birmingham Medical Center, UAB. Helmets will save your life. One of my best friends in the world is a guy named Matthew Seals. Matthew, I met him in 1998. Didn't know him before 1998, but I met him through a horrible circumstance. The tornado outbreak I mentioned, April 8, 1998, the 34th person to die was his 8-year-old boy. You don't know the pain of this until it happens in your family. But I've become good friends with Matthew. What's funny, I always thought that I was put in Matthew's life to encourage him. He lost his ability to walk. Matthew was taken aloft, and he didn't die. He came down, he's lost his mobility, his back was broken, he's in a wheelchair, he's permanently paralyzed, but he didn't die, which is a miracle. But his 8-year-old child did. But he lost his ability to work, he lost his career, he lost his home, everything was gone, his boy. And I thought I was put in his life to encourage him, but you know what's funny, that's not the case. God put him in my life to encourage me. Funny how things work out that way, isn't it? But research, the emergency physicians, the ER physicians at UAB in Birmingham that treated his son. His son's name was Nathan. The ones that treated Nathan said, you know, he'd be alive today if he would have had his bicycle helmet on or his batting helmet. He plays baseball. And that haunts us to this day. We talk about it a lot, and that happened a long time ago. I know for a senior adult it might not make any sense, but you know what? Then again, maybe it does. If you've got a way of putting on a helmet, if you're not in a shelter like this, if you've got a chance of putting on a helmet, put it on. It'll save your life. It will. It sounds silly, but it will save your life. For the younger families, most of them have kids that play sports. We have two boys, they play baseball, and they both smell really bad. Anybody have any boys that played baseball here when they were little? Goodness gracious. And by the way, our kids are 13 years apart. How's that for strange? God has a sense of humor, okay? So we've got a 28-year-old and a 15-year-old. The 15-year-old plays baseball at Spann Park High School in Birmingham. Baseball players smell bad. That's just the way it is. I don't know why. But do you think we got a few batting helmets around our house? I got enough batting helmets to suit up everybody in Brent just about it. But for the families that have children, those helmets can save lives. And yes, we obviously want them on the children, but we want them on the adults as well. So I'm just saying. Sounds kind of silly, doesn't it? Strap on a bicycle helmet and that might save your life. So far, we know of at least 37 people that would be alive today if they would have had a helmet on April 27th. It's very sad, but we've learned that. But here's the practical advice, and I've talked way too long. I never talk more than 30 minutes because I'm a boring speaker. In fact, in Sunday mornings, I get 8 minutes for my sermons, so I've gone way too long. Number one, you've got to get a way of hearing weather warnings. Sure, I'm always on television. I stayed up until 3 o'clock this morning. We didn't have any bad weather, but we have to be there just in case something happens. We're always there if the weather's bad. I promise. You'll turn on the TV, and if there's a tornado warning, I'll be there. I promise. I've never broken that promise in 16 years since we promised that. But you've got to know to turn on the television. We're busy. So I want everybody in here to go buy a weather radio. $29. I know it's a lot of money. But please, please, please do not rely on a siren. You have no hope if that's it. You have no hope. A weather radio, and if you've got one of these slick phones, you can buy a little application that costs about $10 that's even less expensive that will let you know the warning is in effect. You've got to get the warning. That is the biggest issue we've got. And then you've got to have a plan. You've got to know where you're going in your house. Now, if you're going to come down here, you've got no problems. But if you're going to stay at your house, you better know where you're going. And you know the rules. Never go up, you go where? Down. Basement, that's best. If no basement, first floor, you're fine. Small room, hall, closet, bathroom. Everybody in here's got one. Away from windows and near the center, and you'll be fine. And share it with the children. All right, now, we have two tornado seasons in Alabama. What are they? Anybody know? Spring is one. What's the other one? Fall. What season is this? Fall. The core fall season here is November and December. Typically, October is the driest month of the year. It's probably not going to rain for 2 weeks. But then comes November, and that's when things get pretty wild. I don't know why a lot of times the news people, they'll say rare November tornado strikes Alabama. What do you mean rare? They happen a lot. Goodness, the Tuscaloosa tornado, December 16th, 2000, remember that one? December 16th, 9 days before Christmas. They're very common in November, December. So we have to be ready in spring. We have to be ready in fall. What's the fall season going to be like? I have no idea. Sometimes we don't know what the weather's going to do an hour in advance, much less a season in advance, but we have to be ready. And one more thing, and I'll close. I've heard a lot of believers say, well, if it's my time, it's my time. I'm not going to listen to those guys. God's going to take care of me. I'll buy that. But how do you think God's going to take care of you? Has it ever dawned on you that the warnings are part of His provision? I believe that He's equipped certain individuals that were born to do this to give you adequate warning. God does not want you out here on this highway saying, hit me. He gave you the common sense to get in out of the road. He gave us the common sense to be stewards and to go to a safe place during a tornado warning. Please consider that as your attitude if you're a believer. I believe this warning process is part of God's provision. We've had tornadoes. Look, I've been doing this since 1978. You know what? Every year, I've always had an older gentleman. Every single year, I've always had at least one man tell me, I've lived here all my life and I can never remember the weather being this strange. Every year. You know what the truth is? Our weather's kind of strange every year. Our most violent tornado outbreak in terms of deaths, I told you, was March 21st, 1932. The worst heats in Alabama, the 20s and 30s. Anybody know the hottest temperature ever recorded in Alabama? I'll dare you to get the... What do you think? What town... Yeah, you can't answer. I'm sorry. It's against the law, sir. For you to answer... You say Centreville? Yeah, I'll give you credit. It was in Centreville, 112 degrees. The date was September 5th, 1925. So the weather's strange every year. We have heat waves and droughts and hurricanes. We just have to be ready for it. And one more thing, please have a little kit ready in your safe place. It's got your medicine, it's got an ID. If we have a tornado warning, I want you to do one thing for me, all right? I want you to consider putting on shoes. If you're like me, you walk around the house barefooted. Now, maybe I'm just a Butler County redneck. You know, I'm just Butler County, South Alabama. I don't wear shoes a lot. But why do you think we want you to wear shoes? If you take a hit, you have to go walk somewhere. Let me tell you what, you're going to be walking through shrapnel that will shred your feet in a heartbeat. Some of the most serious injuries we saw April 27th were from people that were uninjured from the tornado, but as they tried to walk to get help, their feet were just cut to shreds. These are things you have to think about. You know, medicine, batteries, you know that, but have a little kit ready. We'll be okay. I hope and pray, and again, I really do think it'll be another 40 years before we have another April 27th. But again, all it takes is one down your street, and that's your April 27th. I don't walk around worried about this stuff. I don't worry about much of anything. I firmly believe that I've been told, don't worry. That's biblical. By the way, I didn't say that. Jesus said that. He said three words, do not worry. But I'll walk around people just, they're so eaten up with anxiety, I don't understand that. But I don't worry about severe weather. My family, you know what? I'm never home. My wife has been a weather widow for 31 years. I am never home when there are tornadoes, never. I don't worry about them. You know why? They get the warning, they've got a weather radio, they've got the smartphone apps, and they know where they're going, and they're gonna be fine. So don't worry about this stuff, but just be ready and we'll be fine. Alabama is an incredibly beautiful state with incredibly diverse weather, but it should never be anything we should be afraid of. But thank you all for letting me come speak today, and I've talked way too long, but thank you all very much, and you all have a wonderful day, and thanks for the chance to come down and speak today. Thank you very much.
That's nice.
That's for you.
That's for you, too. And before James gets a bait, Bibb County has invested in Code Red, so our county has made the initial investment in the Code Red system in Bibb County, and all you have to do is put your cell phone number or home phone number in there, and if you're in that polygon, you receive the warning.
Yes, that's
so,
that's it.
So we're already ahead of the game.
You are so far ahead of most counties, you don't even know if y'all are in Code Red.
And you can go to our website, cedarbrentalabama.com. There's a link to go there. If you need help setting up your phone, I'll be glad to help you set it up. So it's available for you.
Now you have no excuse.
No excuse. And it's free.
It doesn't cost anything.
This is the picture of that Kahala River that one of our gentlemen dropped for you to have.
That is fantastic. Yeah, we were talking about my pig trails. That's the river my pig trails are. That is good. Thank you so much. That is absolutely wonderful. I'll tell you a funny story. The first time I ever spoke in public after I came to Birmingham, I had an older guy. He said, son, he called me son. Son, there's only two kinds of people that forecast the weather in Alabama, fools or strangers. And he said, which one are you? I've lived here all my life, so I guess I know now I'm a fool. Sure enough, I pulled my hair out. I mean, it's been a good ride. But thank you so much. This is great. Again, thank you all for being here today. And if we can ever do anything to help, let us know. We're coming up on fall, and think we'll get through it all right, but you gotta be ready. But you got this code red thing going, that's good.
I got it going.
I mean, that'll ring your phone up and it doesn't cost anything.
Before the weather radio on top.
Yeah, you're right. I mean, that's good. We'll find you. Anyway, thank y'all very much. I appreciate that. Y'all have a great day, okay?
Thank you.
This is great. Hold on. Somebody needs it for
There's five of these shelters in Bibb County, so just like this. So if you're close to Woodstock, West Block, and Randolph, they're about to be Yoli, so there's five of them available.